First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to present my work in this conference. Today I'll be discussing understanding global recessions and global recoveries. This is joint work with Ehan Kosi from the research department at IMF. Both being from IMF, the usual disclaimers apply, meaning that what I'm going to say are personal opinions and do not reflect the views of the IMF or IMF policy. Why is it that we are interested in global recessions and global recoveries? Global recession has been a very popular concept since the 2008 episode. Policymakers, bankers, people in the press have been talking about that. Everybody seems to have an idea of what they are talking, but there is no clear definition of global recessions, and for that matter, global business cycles. What we did is try to find out a definition for global recessions, and what we did is to go to the usual sources of information. The first source of information we went was to Wikipedia. And Wikipedia defines a global recession is a period of global economic slowdown. The IMF takes many factors into account when defining a global recession, but it states that global economic growth of 3% or less is equivalent to a global recession. By this measure, four periods since 1985 qualify as global recessions: 1990 to 1993, 98, 2001 to 2002, and 2008 to 2009. Then what we did was to go to another respected source of information, Investopedia. Investopedia defines global recession as an extended period of international economic downturn. Not in the first case, they are talking global economic slowdown. In the second case, they are talking of international economic downturn. Generally, the IMF considers a global recession as a period where gross domestic product is at 3% or less. In addition to that, the IMF looks at declines in real per capita world GDP along with several global macroeconomic factors before confirming a global recession. Next, we went to another source, a Business Dictionary. And Business Dictionary defines global recession as a period of general economic decline that has reached global proportions. The financial crisis in the United States in 2008 sparked a global recession that lasted into 2009. So what's the problem here? The problem is that we don't have a good definition of a global recession. And this is noted by the economists. Indeed, the economists in 2008 mentioned that many economists are now predicting the worst global recessions in the 1930s. Such green warnings discourage spending by households and business, depressing output even more. It is unfortunate, therefore, that there is so much confusion about what pundits mean when they talk about a global recession. The trouble is that there is no agreed definition of global recession. Okay, let's see what other the BBC says about global recession. Leading economic and business leaders are talking about a global recession, but it's not easy to define. Even for national economies, the word recession has more than one meaning. I have heard several different thresholds for judging whether a year counts as a recession. Global output grow below 3%, 2.5%, and 2% have all been suggested. So what we are trying to do in this is try to understand what are global recessions and recoveries. But first, why is it so difficult and why is it important to understand these global cycles? Okay. Why is it so difficult to define global recessions? Because first of all, there is no an easy mapping between national recessions and global recessions. National recessions are defined with quarterly data. There is no quarterly data for the world. There is one can construct quarterly indicators for a set of countries, but for the world as a whole, there is no quarterly data. The best we can do is use yearly data. So there is an issue about the lack of data to analyze global business cycles. The second issue is that a national recession is typically a contraction in GDP, but the world hardly ever declines. Indeed, in the last 50 years, the world has declined only in one year, in 2009. Now, why is it important to study global recessions? First of all, for institutions like IMF that do surveillance to the economies and to the world economy, to understand global recessions and global recoveries is very important because of the nature of the work we do over there. Perhaps more importantly, one would like to understand global recessions and global recoveries to identify whether these recessions and recoveries were driven by idiosyncratic shocks or by global shocks. Those make a difference. Okay? Idiosyncratic shocks can be addressed with policy responses at the national level. Global shocks perhaps need for policy coordination. Okay? Several countries together perhaps need to coordinate their policies in order to address a global shock. Now, what do we do here? In this study, we provide comprehensive analysis of global recessions and global recoveries. Indeed, we postulate three questions. The first question is, what's a global recession and what's a global recovery? And in particular, what are the main features of global recessions and global recoveries? The second question we are going to address in this presentation is, how different are the latest global recessions and the ongoing recovery relative to the past recessions and recoveries? And the final question we are going to address is, how are the national cycles related to the global cycle? You know, are they, how the cycles in each country relate to the global cycle if we find one? With regard to the first question, what's a global recession and what's a global recovery, and what are the main features of these episodes, this is what we have found. A global recession corresponds to a contraction in the world per capita GDP. This contraction is accompanied by a decline in several indicators of global economic activity. And since the year 1960, we have identified four global recessions, the recessions in 1975, 1982, 1991, and 2009. So there are, in the last 50 years, there have been only four global recessions that we are able to identify. Now, a global recovery, in turn, is a rebound in output growth together with a recovery in the other activities, in the other indicators of economic activity. And usually the recovery is measured 1 year after the recession or even 3 years after the recession. Okay? Now, how different are the latest global recessions and ongoing recoveries? Okay? The latest global recession, as you know, has been the most severe one in the last 50 years. And also, it has been the most synchronized. Several economies around the world fell into recession, and this has been, you know, a problem that has affected the strength of the current recovery. Now, the latest recovery, and this might surprise to many of you, has been comparable to early ones. You know, it has been as strong as previous recoveries. However, this masks two important divergences in what we have observed in the past. First, there is a divergence of economic activity, meaning that this recovery has been the weakest for the advanced economies and has been the strongest for the emerging market economies. And the second divergence that we identify is what we are calling a divergence of policies, mainly in the advanced economies. While policies were aligned in the past, meaning policies were accommodative to the recovery in the previous episodes, now fiscal and monetary policy have marched in different directions, as we are going to show. With regard to the third question, how are national cycles related to global cycles? National cycles are tightly linked to the global cycle. They are more sensitive to the recessions than to the expansions. And the degree of sensitivity of national cycles depends on the degree of trade and financial openness, as we are going to show. Now, the outline of this presentation is as follows. First, I'll describe briefly the database and methodology. Second, I'll define what we understand by global recessions and what we understand by what's global recovery and identify their main features. Third, we'll examine how different is the latest recession and the latest recovery compared to the previous episodes. Next, we'll examine how the national cycles are related to the global cycle. And lastly, we'll conclude. Okay? Now, with regard to the database and methodology, we have 180 countries covering the period from 1960 to 2011. And indeed, we use up to 2014 for the forecast. This data comes from different sources, including the WIO database where we obtain the forecast. Now, we, in order to examine global business cycles, we need several indicators of global economic activity. And these indicators we characterize them as coming in two groups, the macro variables, basically the real GDP, consumption, investment, industrial production, trade, unemployment, inflation rates, interest rates, and government expenditures, and the financial variables, including credit, equity prices, house prices, and capital flows. Now, in order to put together this database, as I mentioned, we use the WIO database, but also several other databases like the World Developing Indicators, the OECD, and many other sources. Now, in order to define a global recession, we need to have a methodology, okay? And the thing we started doing is to think about the world as being another country. How will you identify the cycles in this country that is the total of all the other countries? When you examine the national cycles, you use two complementary methods to identify the peaks and troughs of the business cycle, okay? The first method is the statistical method. With the statistical method, basically what we do is identify the peaks and troughs on real GDP, which is the measure of economic activity. There is the Brian Boshan methodology that is typically followed in this kind of studies. And Harding and Pagan have developed a program that's easy to apply. So it's very easy to apply this statistical method. And we have applied then to examine real and financial cycles in this paper with these other co-authors I have. Now, the second method is the judgmental method. Basically, the idea is that cycles or recessions involve a decline, involve a decline of several activities at the same time. So the National Bureau of Economic Research in the United States, in addition to looking at the real GDP, they look at retail sales, industrial production, employment, the disposable income, and the initial claims for unemployment insurance to reach a judgment whether a country is in a recession or not. Okay? In order to develop or to identify the turning points at the global level, we do a similar application of these two methods. Okay? First of all, we are going to use the statistical method, again, identifying the peaks and troughs of world per capita GDP. Now, why is it that we are using the world per capita GDP as opposed to the GDP that's been used in other in the studies? The reason is that countries grow at different speeds. You know, the emerging markets are growing at higher speeds than the advanced economies. But also, the emerging markets have faster population growth rates. So we need to control for this. So by doing the per capita world GDP, we address the issue of the GDP taking different trends and having different population growth rates. Now, we need a global cycle that lasts at least 2 years, okay? But typically the cycle is going to last more than that. But the requirement we impose is that the global cycle lasts at least 2 years and that the duration of the recession is at least 1 year, okay? Now, in addition to this statistical method, we use some judgmental method, looking at a broad set of indicators, including the output per capita, the industrial production at the global level, unemployment at the global level, oil consumption at the global level, trade and capital flows. Okay, and with this information, we reach a conclusion whether the world is facing a global recession or not. Now, in the second part of the second point of the outline was, what's a global recession, what's a global recovery, and what are the main features of these episodes? Now I'm going to cover this point. What's a global recession? A global recession, as I mentioned to you, is defined here as a decline in world per capita GDP that's associated with a combined decline or a synchronized decline in other indicators of economic activity. Now, using this methodology, we identify four global recessions, the recessions in 75, 82, 91, and 2009. That means that the unconditional probability of the world being in a recession is 7.5. In addition, what we find is that the 2009 recession is the most severe one and also the most synchronized. Now, the average decline on the world per capita GDP in a recession period is 0.75%, which means 3% below the average in non-recession periods. So it's a significant drop for the world. It seems a small number, but for the world economy, it's a significant world. Now, let me show you how the statistical method works when we are trying to identify the peaks and troughs of the world per capita GDP. This is the index of world per capita GDP. The blue line is using PPP weights, and the red line is using market weights. Okay, so that is how the world output looks when we construct these indices, using starting out from the growth rates of the different countries and weighting these growth rates using PPP weights in the blue line case or using the market weights in the red line case. Now, in order to see how the world has been growing, these are the growth rates coming out from these two lines there. These are the per capita growth rate of the world GDP. Again, the blue line reflects the PPP weights and the red line the market weights. Now, notice that there are four periods where there is a recession highlighted by this method. You know, as I mentioned, 75, 82, 91, and 2009. Now, when we use the market weights, we obtain similar results, except that in the year 91, the recession became a two-year event. Okay, but otherwise, pretty much the results are similar. Also, notice that before the recession, there is a sharp drop in economic activity in the recession of 75 and in the recession of 2009. And the drop in economic activity in the run-up to the recession is more gradual in the 82 recession and in the 2001 recession. What is happening in 1975? In 1975, as you will remember, there was the oil shock. Okay, oil prices skyrocket, and as a result, the economies went into recession. This episode can be thought as an episode that's truly driven by a global shock to the global economy. And this global shock was coming from the oil price shock. Now, what happened in the year 82? In the year 82, we have several events that affected the global economy. First of all, we have the remnants of the 1979 global shock. The second problem we had in 1982 is that the monetary policy in the advanced economies tightened. And the third problem we had in 1982 was that several emerging markets went into crisis because of the debt crisis. Okay, so in here we have a combination of things happening that brought the global economy to a recession. What happened in 1991? In 1991, we have financial problems in Japan. Indeed, we have the burst of the bubble in Japan. Also, we have the savings and loans problems in the United States. And also, what we had is that several European countries had currency crisis, the ERM crisis, in this period. So this, in many ways, can be thought of the first global recession driven by financial factors. Okay, so the 1991 recession was, in many ways, driven by financial factors. How about the 2009 recession? The 2009 recession was driven by the problems, the housing problems in the United States, that spread out quickly to all the advanced economies. And also, this is another recession driven by financial factors. So there are, in general, the type of shocks that are driving these recessions vary. In 75, we have the oil shocks. And in these last two recessions, we have the problems, the financial sector problems. Then what we did is to examine what happens with these other variables around this period. We have been looking at what happens to the global industrial production, the global unemployment, the global oil consumption, trade and capital flows, to see whether, you know, there was also a decline in these indicators of global economic activity. And, when we look at output per capita, this is just a reaffirmation of what we saw, is that the first thing we notice is that 2009 is the largest or the more severe recession that we had in this period. Okay? The 1975 and the 1991 recessions were not as severe. Indeed, world output dropped by -0.2%. Okay? While in here, output dropped by 1.8%. Okay? This is what happens with the world output in other years that are not recession. This is the per capita output, by the way. Now, at the time of these recessions, something happened with consumption and investment. As what happens with global consumption drops in some cases, in other cases it slows down, but this is similar to the result we have observed in national economies. You know, there is some consumption smoothing even at the global level. What happens with investment? Notice that investment drops substantially during a global recession, and the drop of investment is particularly strong in the year 2009, okay? Now, what happens with global industrial production? Global industrial production, as you see, drops in 3 out of the 4 global recessions, so therefore, you know, and also the drop in 2009 is very severe. What happens with oil consumption? Oil consumption also tends to drop during global recession. What happens with global unemployment? This is a combination of unemployment in the emerging markets and advanced economies. The unemployment rates tend to rise during global recessions. You know, many people will be surprised to see this chart because there is, when reading the news, it seems that the unemployment rate in this global recession has shot up tremendously. Okay, the reason why this increase in unemployment rate is smaller than this increase is because in here you had an increase in unemployment rate in the emerging markets, while mainly this increase reflects what's happening in the advanced economies. So that's why most of this increase in unemployment is driven by what's happening in the advanced economies. Now, at an international level, we notice that the trade flows have declined in global recessions, but not this sharp drop in 2009. Many people have been studying why is it that international trade has declined too much in 2009. There is stories about that the credit for international trade collapsed. There is also stories that the global manufacturing chain also failed to deliver. And also, there is stories about the importance of durable goods in this last recession. Note also that capital flows tend to decline sharply in periods of global recession. Now, putting it together, as you can see here, you know, in global recessions, most of the indicators are falling. Output, industrial production, unemployment, oil consumption, total trade, and capital flows. But notice that not all global recessions are similar, okay? In some cases, the global recession in the case of 1991, 3 out of the 5 indicators go in the right direction. You know, despite the global economy being in global recession, here international trade is rising in 1991. So that was kind of strange, that happening. And the main reason is that, remember, in 1991, Japan and the United States went into recession, but the euro area was not still in a recession. The euro area went into recession in 1992. Then the other extreme of behavior is what happens here in 2009, not all the decline in the different indicators we have been looking at. Now, what happens with the financial sector variables? When there is a global recession, there is a slowdown in credit. And you can see that in the red bar. Red bar reflects here credit. Credit tends to decline or slow down. You know, I don't have in here with the dynamics of what's happening with each of these variables, but you will see a slowdown in credit in these recessions. The second thing that you will notice is that in global recessions, house prices tend to drop. House prices are the yellow bars. You know, not how they tend to drop, but fundamentally, in a global recession, the equity prices always drop. Okay? Note that how the equity prices always fell in a global recession. Now, next, let's examine what happened with the synchronization of recession at around the time of global recessions. You know, how synchronized are national recessions around these episodes of global recession? We, not surprisingly, find that a large fraction of countries in recession went up at the time of a global recession. You know, the number of countries in recession, you know, the national individual countries, the fraction of those countries went up at the time of a global recession. In all global recessions, the fraction of countries entering in recession started to pick up ahead, 1 year ahead of the global recession. So some countries go into recession ahead of the global recession. And there are two periods of what we call global downturns. Those periods are the years 1998 and 2001, where global economic activity slows down, but it doesn't go to negative territory. And in this case, the fraction of countries in recession was low compared to the other cases, you know. Finally, the financial disruptions play an important role in these episodes, as I have mentioned. Now, you can see here how the fraction of recession of countries that went into recession move at the time over time. And the red arrows tell you the recession periods, not how these are the number of countries going into recession weighted by their importance in the contribution to the world output. Okay? So note how synchronized was the year 2009, and that's why it was so severe. Now, what is a global recovery? A global recovery, when we think about global recoveries at the national level, we are thinking about the early part of an expansion, meaning is the first year or the first 3 years of an expansion. Now, usually, what we are doing at the global level is replicating what is being done at the national level. So what we do define as a global recovery is basically is the rebound in global economic activity the first year or the 3 first years after the recession. Now, so this pickup in global economic activity is mainly driven by an increase in consumption, an increase in global investment, and also by an increase in international trade. However, what we notice is that in this recovery process, the unemployment rates remain high. So this is how the output looks at the time of global recoveries. This is 1 year after the recession. Look how fast the rebounds tend to be in some cases. This is the rebound in the year 75, after the 76, after the 75 global recession. And this is the rebound in the year 2010. Again, this chart might surprise you because people are talking about weak global recession in the year 2000, global recovery in the year 2010. Okay, but in here we are saying that the rebound was strong. And the rebound in the year 1992 was very weak. Now, what happened with this rebound when we measured it 3 years after the recession? Again, what we notice is that the recoveries in 76 to 78 and the recoveries in 2010 to 2012 were rather strong. And the recovery in 1992 to 1994 was very weak. Now, this is what happened with all the indicators of global economic activity put together in terms of a rebound. Notice that in all cases, all the different indicators, you know, the output, which is in the red bar, the industrial production, which is in the yellow bar, the oil consumption, which is in the orange bar, and the trade flows, which is in the light blue line or bar, and capital flows, which is in the green bar, tend to recover in the recovery process. But notice that unemployment tends to be sluggish in some cases. You know, in some cases, unemployment worsens even in the recovery process, but in other cases, unemployment declines. You know, in this case, unemployment is worsening, and in this case, unemployment improves slightly. Now, what happens in the financial sector when we are talking about a global recovery? First of all, credit tends to speed up. Credit is the red line. As you can see, it tends to accelerate. House prices tend to recover only in the 75 to 78 recovery. But then house prices continue falling in the recession, in the recoveries of 83 to 85, and in the recoveries of 92 to 94, and in the recoveries from 2010 to 2012. So the house prices continue falling appears to be the norm in the case of global recoveries. Also notice that equity prices rebound quickly in three out of the four recoveries. You know, the issue is why equity prices didn't rebound in 1976 to 1978. Remember, in those periods, there was the stagflation where, you know, there was a lot of uncertainty and concerns about the state of the economy. So equity prices were falling. Okay? So to answer what the first question we have established is that what's a global recession and what's a global recovery? What are the main features of these episodes? As we have already covered, a global recession corresponds to a contraction in world GDP together with the contraction in other indicators of global economic activity. There are four episodes of global recessions, and the 2009 is the more severe one. A global recovery corresponds to a rebound of economic activity together with the other indicators of economic activity. How different are the latest global recession and the ongoing recovery? This is a question that many people have been asking, and there is some debate on this issue. So let's look at the latest recession and the recovery and see how different it was from the past. In here, we are drawing the per capita GDP index, and we are putting that index to be 100, the year of the recession, the year of the trough. So the year of the trough means the year where the economy starts recovering. So this is the lowest point. The first thing to notice is that the recession in the year 2009, that's in here with red line, was very severe, which was the point we already made. But the recovery from this recession has been very strong. You know, the red line here has been as strong as the recoveries in the past, and even stronger than most of the recoveries in the past. So this global recovery has been very strong. Okay? So that's the first thing that surprised us, because many people were talking about that the global recovery was weak. Okay, so what we did next is to examine what happens in the different country groups. So we started looking at what happens in the advanced economies and what happens in the emerging markets, and drew again these indices of per capita GDP in these two country groups. So in the left panel, you have the advanced countries, and in the right panel, you have the emerging market economies. Again, the red line is the latest recovery, and the blue line, U1, is the average of the previous ones. So what do we learn from these two charts? The first thing we learn in the case of the advanced economies is that this recovery is one of the weakest, or the weakest, for the advanced economies. Okay? What else do we learn from this chart? that this recovery is one of the strongest ones for the emerging market economies. As you can see here, this is the strongest recovery that the emerging market economies have had. Okay, so when people are talking about weak recoveries, they are basically referring to the recoveries in the advanced economies. But for the global economy as a whole, this recovery has been as good as the ones in the past. Now, let's look at the different, what happened with consumption, and then next we are going to see what happened with investment, what has happened in this recovery. Notice that, first of all, consumption in the advanced economies dropped in the year of the recession. The red dot means the what happened with consumption the year of the recession. And in here you see that the consumption in the advanced economies have dropped. Okay? And notice the weak recovery that it has had in the subsequent years. The yellow bar here means what happens 1 year after the recession. The blue dot here means 2 years after the global recession. And the orange means 3 years after the global recession. Notice that consumption has not recovered much in the advanced economies. But notice what's happening in the advanced economy, in the emerging markets. In the emerging markets, first of all, consumption didn't drop during the recessions. And on top of that, consumption is buoyant. So the emerging markets have been doing quite well. And indeed, when I went to Peru, people were very happy with what was happening over there. And I understand also people here were happy on what was happening in terms of activity. Now, what happened with investment? Notice that investment in all global recessions tend to fall in the case of the advanced economies. And that the drop in the year 2009 was very severe. Okay? In the recovery period, this is how much investment has recovered. So still, investment is way below what it had fallen in the recession period. Now, compare that with emerging markets. Investment, in the case of the emerging markets, didn't fall. Investment was growing in the year of the recession, and it has continued growing in the years of the recovery. So investment, again, has been also strong in the emerging markets. No surprise that the emerging markets were doing quite well. Now, what happens with unemployment? You know, people talk about high levels of unemployment around the world. Again, the left panel reflects the unemployment rate in the advanced economies, and the right panel, the unemployment rate in the emerging markets. Notice the sharp increase of unemployment. In the red line reflects the 2009 recession and recovery. The sharp increase in that episode. And also notice the high levels of unemployment compared to the previous ones. So the levels of unemployment are very high compared to the past. So that's why we have problems in the advanced economies. The unemployment levels are very high. What's happening in the case of the emerging markets? Well, again, the red line, the unemployment rate has been higher compared to historic norms, but is still at around 6%, which is much higher, much lower, much smaller than what's happening in the advanced economies. Now, many people have been asking why you see that the recovery in the advanced countries is different, okay? There are some theories that suggest that recoveries from recessions associated with financial crisis tend to be sluggish. This is a point that Reinhardt and Rogoff did in 2009. Also, some people have been talking that recoveries with high uncertainty tend to be weaker. And indeed, some people have found that the levels of uncertainty in the advanced economies have increased as a result of uncertainty in economic policies. This is the work of Bloom and co-authors there. But also, it seems that it's worth it to look at what's happening with macroeconomic policies at different points, okay? So what we have noticed is that first of all, there is a divergence of policies around the different episodes. First, we see a contraction of government expenditures in the advanced economies in this recovery, the red line, compared to the blue line, which is the average of the previous ones. And in the case of the emerging markets, we see that fiscal policy has been very accommodative to economic activity. This pattern of contraction holds across the different country groups in the advanced economies. Look at the contraction that's happening in the United States, in the euro area, and the United Kingdom. So there is a sharp contraction of government expenditures in these economies. At the same time, this contraction is happening when monetary policy, in the case of the advanced countries, has hit the zero interest rate bound, and that has brought challenges to the management of monetary policy in these economies. Notice how the balance sheets of these central banks have grown as a result of the unconventional measures they have implemented. This has never happened before. And there are questions about what's going to happen later. Now, was this mixture of contracting fiscal policy and expansive monetary policy driven by different factors? We find that the contracting fiscal policy could be explained by the high levels of debt that the advanced countries had coming into the recession. You see, before the recession, the levels of debt were high already, and then they went higher, okay? And that compares with the previous episodes like this. And in the case of the emerging markets, the public debt levels are very reduced, okay? And the other reason why this policy differ this time is that inflation rates are controlled this time. Look at this is what's happening now compared to the inflation rate in past episodes. So the central banks could able to expand their balance sheets. So since I don't have additional time to continue with this, what I'm going to do is go directly to the conclusions and say that the global economy has experienced four global recessions and recovery since 1960. The global recessions feature synchronized declines in worldwide activity, and global recoveries are accompanied by rebounding activity driven by a pickup in consumption, investment, and trade. The 2009 recession was a unique episode, and the recovery from this episode has been very strong and comparable to previous episodes. Okay. However, in there we observe two kinds of divergences in activities. Remember, the recovery in the advanced economies are very weak, and compared to the recoveries in the emerging markets. And also there is a divergence in policies. You know, the fiscal policy has been contractive this time compared to previous cases. And this point I didn't cover, so I won't read it. Okay.
Well, thank you very much, Marco. I'm sorry that I have to interrupt you because of the time. During the time, we're going to have the chance to have at the most three questions.
Domenico Giannone from the Università Libre di Bruxelles. Just wondering why you are dating the business cycle using per capita GDP instead of the level of the growth rate of GDP itself. Dating would completely look different. For example, I think there will be only one global recession if you don't do per capita.
Well, there are two main reasons why we use per capita GDP. The first one you already mentioned is that when we look at global GDP that's not per capita, you know, the measure of global economic activity, there is only one recession. It will be 2009. But the perhaps the most important reason is that when you examine what's happening in the world, you find countries growing at different trends. The advanced economies growth has been slowing down since the 60s, while the emerging markets activity growth has been increasing over time. Okay, so there is a different path in terms of the trends of this growth. But at the same time, you also see differences in the population growth. You know, the population growth in the advanced economies is declining, while the population growth in the emerging markets has been declining, but also has been high. So by doing the per capita, we control in part for this problem. So that's the main motivation.
Somewhat similar question on measurement. You know, to me, working with global data, one of the big issues is how you actually aggregate things on a global basis. And I guess my question, which is kind of my big complaint to the IMF regularly, is why are you using PPP weights? And I don't think it makes much difference in your dating, but I think it does make a difference using PPP weights and how you think about this recovery, given that the PPP weights give China a much bigger weight than the market weights. I mean, given that PPP weights do skew things much more towards emerging markets, given that PPP weights don't reflect the way currencies are moving over time by any, I don't think there's anything that suggests they're going in that direction very quickly. What's the argument for using PPP weights, and also does the results that you have about the recovery show sensitivity to that? I guess the other point, just asking briefly, is when you're getting away from GDP data, how are you actually aggregating things like global house prices, global credit, global, you know, global everything that's not a GDP measure?
Well, this is the eternal debate whether to use market weights or PPP weights. Indeed, in the IMF, we use both of them. And that's why I was showing the two series that were constructed. You can use PPP weights for certain kind of analysis. In our case, it didn't matter. It only affected the dating of one of the episodes. It was the 1991 recession that became a two-year recession episode. You ask whether this makes a difference for the recoveries. It doesn't make much difference. The results tend to be robust. You ask how to aggregate the financial variables. Well, when we examine financial data, the way we aggregate is using market weights. You know, the house prices are weighted using GDP in market weights, you know, in order to construct a global aggregate of global house prices or a global aggregate of equity prices or credit. So we use the GDP as a weight, as a shortcut to what should be done. Ideally, you would like to have, in the case of credit, you have information and you could use the importance of credit in each economy to weight. But in the case of housing, you don't have information about the size of the housing markets. So it's much harder to do the aggregation going for the importance of house market. And only house prices are available, so you use the economy as a weight to create these global aggregates.
Have time for one more question. Well, if there's none, people should be a little bit hungry. Well, I'm going to thank you very much, our two guest speakers. It was a very good presentation. And the second session is going to start at 2:30.